excited about this first series of teaching here at 200 Greens Road in Greens Point. We begin this new series entitled Embrace Your Journey. Embrace Your Journey. In the book of Genesis chapter 12, while you're searching the scriptures, you shouldn't have to search that far for the book of Genesis. Give God praise for the ministry of music. Give God praise for all those that are working in the parking lot. And give God praise for all the men and women who made this place transform in a few days. We give God praise. Give God praise. In the book of Genesis, chapter 12, we will look at this morning, verse 7, 8, and 9. The Bible says, "Then the Lord appeared to Abram and said, 'To your descendants I will give this land.' And there he built an altar to the Lord who had appeared to him. And he moved from there to a mountain east of Bethel, and he pitched his tent with Bethel on the west and Ai on the east. There he built an altar to the Lord and called on the name of the Lord." Verse number 9 is what I really want you to focus on. So Abram journeyed going on still toward the south. Take your seat and say, embrace your journey.
Embrace your journey.
And notice I said embrace your journey, not the journey, because we all have individual journeys we must embrace. Journey, defined by Webster's Dictionary, is simply the act of traveling from one place to another. You took a journey to get here. You journeyed from your home to church this morning to travel from one place to another. I got kind of nervous last season when people start doing the mannequin challenge, because it makes me nervous. People are standing still too long. We were not designed to stay still. We was designed to journey. We were designed to have motion and movement and to do something. God did not create us for us to stand still. He created us to be movers and shakers. So I'm so glad the mannequin challenge is over, so the body of Christ can get back to being about my Father's business, to travel from one place to another. And then I was shocked that Webster even included in the definition of journey a long and often difficult process of personal change and development. Now that's the journey that we all can be familiar with, a long, often difficult process of personal change and development. But you do know when you grow, it hurts to grow. You do know that when you're making motion, things become uncomfortable, but you're never supposed to quit when things become uncomfortable. You're supposed to use the uncomfortableness as a measuring tool of how far you've come and how far you're going, but never stop journeying because it gets difficult. For a matter of fact, I need you to do yourself a favor in 2017. Learn how to embrace your journey. See, many have become frustrated and overcome with negative thoughts and feelings because they've never really learned how to embrace their life journey. That's why social media is so hot, because people are so conditioned to watching and following someone else's journey that we lose focus of our own journey. I appreciate the fact that you want me to know everything you're doing, but at this season of my life, I gotta do what I've been called to do. I gotta grab hold to my journey. I have to embrace my journey. I have to do what God called me to do. And if we will spend more time developing and focusing on our own journeys, our lives wouldn't be so dysfunctional and we wouldn't feel so incomplete all the time. But if you keep bowling your ball down my lane, you'll be frustrated because you'll get no points. I'm not concerned about what they're doing at the church around the corner. That's their journey. We're on our own journey. Look at the insides of your hands. Look at the insides of your hand. Look at the insides of your hands. And focus on your fingerprints. Focus on your fingerprints, because I want you to know something. There are over 7 billion people in the world. The world population right now is around 7 billion people. But no two people have the same fingerprints, because God created each and every one of us and assigned us to a personal journey. That's why we all have different fingerprints, because our hands were purposed and designed to do something unique, that God created us to fill a void in the earth realm. God didn't need another T.D. Jakes when he made me. God needed an E.A. God didn't need another Joel Osteen. Steve, when he called me, he needed an EA. He needed a kid from the hood that had enough hood in him to save the hood, but enough wisdom to walk in boardrooms. God knew exactly what he was doing when he created me. That's why he gave me a different set of fingerprints. But guess what? He gave you a different set of fingerprints also, because you have a journey. You have an assignment. You have a purpose. You're not here by mistake. You're not here because your mom and daddy got together and forgot about you. You're here because God had divine purpose. That's why he gave you a set of fingerprints for you to do something with your life.
Embrace your journey.
Embrace your journey. And we're going to walk through this Bible. We're going to walk through this Bible in 2017. We're going to learn how to embrace our journey. And we're going to walk by faith and walk dead smack into our full potential. I'm sick and tired of seeing folks come to church being empty. I'm sick and tired of seeing people losing in the kingdom of God. We're supposed to have winning families, winning finances, winning health. We're supposed to be the billboards. We're supposed to be the one people look at and say, I want to be like them. But you've got to embrace your journey for the world to see the favor of God on your life.
Yes, yes, yes.
And this is the key.
Yes.
God says he'll never leave us nor forsake us. So we have a built-in advantage. Because if God says he'll never leave us nor forsake us, and then God says it doesn't matter who's against us as long as he's with us. So we have a built-in, the game is rigged. We will win if we stick with God. That's why you can embrace your journey without fear, because as long as you're on your journey following what God said for you to do, God will be with you. He'll protect you, provide for you. He will keep you. Even when you fall, he'll pick you back up. You don't have anybody in here that can testify that if you happen to fall along the way, that God will pick you back up.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, God. Thank you, Lord. In 2017, stop focusing on who's against you, who don't like you. We've overused that term, hater. I'm not going to give anybody that's anti-EA another moment of my time nor energy. Either you with God or you against God. I'm not concerned if you like me or not. And understand this, if we're going to move forward, and when you get in your car and you turn on your ignition, there must be a positive and a negative force to go forward. If you're trying to eliminate all the negative forces out of your life, you're going to be stuck in the parking lot. But I got somewhere to go, so I need all the negative energy I can get, because the negative energy connect with my positive energy. I'm ready to... I'm ready to take off. So you have to have some negativity around you. So embrace the negativity. Salute the negativity. Because without it, you get coupled and you get stuck. You spend too much time and energy on them. Now focus on your journey. Well, watch this. Look at this. God says in Genesis 12 and 9, Abram, his journey kept going. His journey kept going. Well, one verse of the Bible says it, Abram journey going on still. What does that mean, preacher? His journey going on still in spite of whatever he just went through. You do know the Bible says man is born but a few days, but full of trouble. But don't let that trouble stop you from keep going forward. You got to still keep going. I dare you to hit your name and say, still keep going. I know somebody lied on you, but still keep going. I know somebody hurt you, but still keep going. I know it gets hard sometimes, but still keep going. You must commit to keep going no matter how many roadblocks, detours, or setbacks you encounter along the way. You got to make your mind up. This season of my life, I'm not going to put the park brakes on. I'm not going to sit still. I'm not going to be a whiner. I'm not going to be a complainer. I'm going to be a doer. And no matter what I go against, I'm going to still keep going. Well, that was Abraham. Abraham, he was special. Abraham was the father of faith. But now, flip your Bible back to chapter 11, verse 26. Let's look at Abraham's beginning, because you'll be surprised that most of the Bible heroes started out in a dysfunctional, jacked up manner, because God God wanted you and I to know there are no excuses for us not to reach our destiny. No matter what you come out of, God is saying, if you just trust me, if you just roll with me, I can get you where you're going. So when I look at the life of Abram's early life, his father, Terah, his father was ungodly. His father was a good man, but not a godly man. That's the difference between being good and godly. His father was provider, but his father wasn't a prayer warrior. His father was around, but his father didn't teach him the ways of God. So Abram came from a heathen culture. Abram came, he had two brothers, and his younger brother died early in life, so he had to deal with grief early in life, but that didn't stop him. And then, to make matters even more complicated, he fell in love with a chick that couldn't have a baby. Ah, you missed that right there. You missed that. See, back there in that society, a man was judged by his ability to produce a son. Every man in the Bible, Old Testament, his pride was, I gotta make me a son. I gotta have a junior. I gotta have somebody I can leave my legacy to. It was very important in the Bible for a man to leave a legacy, and he couldn't leave it to his daughter because his daughter would go and marry some joker and take his last name. So you had to have a son to keep your name going. So Abram falls in love with a woman that can't have a baby. But the Bible says he keeps going. Anyhow, I wish I had somebody here that made your mind up that I'm going to keep going. Anyhow, because what the Bible is saying here with the genesis of Abram's life is that it does not, let me repeat this over, and it does not matter where you start or how you start. That's not what's important. What's important is how you end and where you end. You can lose some games along the way and still win a championship. You gotta just keep playing the game. You gotta keep believing. You gotta keep catching the ball. You gotta keep making the passes. You gotta stay in the game to win. But Abram says, in fact, in spite of the fact that my wife got some issues and my baby brother died and my community's all jacked up, I gotta keep going. I gotta keep going. And then on his way, in Genesis 11 and 32, on his way to Cana. You do know the Bible refers to Cana as being the land of promise, right? Have you ever heard that? The Cana is the land of promise. And on his way to Cana, his father now dies. What kind of trick is God playing? My little brother dies on this journey. Now my daddy dies on this journey. And when his father died, his brother right on him decided, I'm going to stay right here. I'm not going any farther. This too hard. This too difficult. I'm going to stay right here. His other brother stayed stuck at his daddy's funeral. He never got over it. Never was able to make any more moves. But Abram said, as hard as it is, weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. Abram said, I got to get up because I got some life to live. Yes, my brother died and my daddy died, but I can't die. I got too much destiny inside of me. I got too much to do. I gotta stay on this journey. Yes, sometimes I gotta cry. Sometimes I gotta limp. Sometimes I gotta hop. But I gotta keep moving. God called me to this journey and I can't stop here. Major point right here, Prentice. Along this journey, many around you may give up, may decide it's too hard, but you gotta be a man of faith, a woman of faith, Tony, and make your mind up. No matter who quit or drop out, I gotta keep going. And if I keep going, maybe my story will encourage you to get up and get back on. So Abram decides that, brother, I love you, but I can't stay stuck here. It's too much. Can't stay. You're stuck. Stuck here. Can't stay stuck here. So Abram had no idea what was getting ready to bust loose in Genesis 12 and 1, but it would never happen. Watch this. It would have never happened if he would have stayed stuck. Because in Genesis 12 and 1, God tells Abram it's time to get out. And when you get out, I'm going to make you a great nation. I'm going to bless you. I'm going to make your name great. You shall be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you. There was so much attached to Abram keep going. There was so much attached to him being able to not get stuck in any situation, but to keep journeying along the way. See, we miss some of our blessings because we get stuck. God has something in store for us. God has something with your name on it, but it's not in front of you. It's around the corner, but you get stuck here, so you never get around the corner because you didn't see what was around the corner. So you get stuck here with your blessing, your breakthrough, your increase, your promotion, your territory was right around the corner. You got stuck at your last defeat. You got stuck at your last. But God told Abram to get out. See, a journey requires movement. A journey requires movement. You got to stop standing still. Stop living in the past. I dare you to declare, my best days are yet ahead. My best days are yet ahead. Joy is ahead. Increase ahead. Prosperity ahead. Peace ahead. Single woman, Boaz is ahead. Single man, your prince is ahead. Your princess. Your princess. Genesis 12 and 1. Get out. But watch this. This is how clear the Bible is. Because when you keep reading, you get to verse 4. It says Abram was 75 years old. That makes no logical sense. Why would a 75-year-old man launch out on a new journey? Why would somebody 75 years old decide that I'm getting ready to bust a move? Because God was going to use Abram to let you and I know that age is not a factor. Faith is the only factor that God considers. Jeremiah was not too young, nor was not too old. So Abraham said that I'm going to trust God. And if God says go, I'm going to go. You may have never seen a 75-year-old papa, but I'm going to go. I'm going to trust God, and I'm going to make me a baby. I know y'all say my wife too old and she's barren, but I'm going to trust God, and I'm going to keep practicing till it works. Yeah. 75 years old. But your name say God's concerned about your faith, not your age. No one is too young nor too old. Just get in and keep running. And as Abram started to tribulate and move, the Bible says he journeyed into Canaan. But this is a very interesting twist in this story. Everybody else wanted to get to Canaan. But when he got to Canaan, he didn't stay in Canaan because that was not his destination. That was the destination of his father. That was his father's dream. That was everybody else's dream to get to Canaan. They called the promised land, but it wasn't for him. It was only a pit stop for him. And many of us get confused and we get so lost on somebody else's journey that we think we've arrived at our promised land, but that was for somebody else. That wasn't for you. That's why you got to continue to hear God's spiritual GPS for your life. That may have been my daddy's dream, that may have been my brother's dream, but that wasn't what God called me to do. And stop letting people make you a hostage to their desires. You better go where God called you to go. You better do what God told you to do. Stop letting people talk you out of your destination. It's your journey. Look at your fingerprints. If they don't have your fingerprints, they don't know your assignment. They don't know what God told you in the middle of the night. They don't know what you've been praying and fasting for. Stop letting folks talk you out of it. I'm sure somebody said, why is that man trying to do all of that? Because God said I could. I showed up one night at a very violent scene. Gangs and drugs everywhere. The blood of a young lady was still on the ground. Weed and marijuana was so strong that I almost dropped out. I told the community, y'all stand still. Shut up. Sit down. We're going to pray. They looked and said, who is that little man? But next thing, everybody started praying.
All right.
Rem Hall was with me and 27 people gave their life to Christ. while the blood was still running down the sidewalk. One man said, "Brother, why you wasn't scared of us?" I said, "Because you see the blood, but I walk in the blood." The blood of Jesus. But you gotta know your assignment. See, if you try to copy somebody else's assignment, you'll lose your life. You'll get frustrated. That's why many get burnt out in church workers. You try to do it like somebody else. That was their journey. That was their assignment. You can't. There's a whole generation. Get ready, get ready, get ready. You're not ready. Be you. And if you be you, you're saying, "God, I appreciate you for uniquely creating me and making me and giving me my assignment, so I'm a journey with God." Because you notice, everywhere Abram went, and he went a lot of places, but everywhere he went, he made an altar for God. Because Abram realized that every time I make a stop, I gotta include God. I just want to encourage you in 2017, don't go without God. Don't do anything without God. Don't say yes without God. Don't say no without God. Don't move without God. Don't stand still without God. Whatever you do this season, make sure you've heard from God. And when you hear from God, things start to fall in place. I gotta leave you right here. But for my note takers, I'm gonna give you 5 distinctive points to embrace your journey. Number 1, dysfunctional family tree. But keep going. Stop blaming your mama and your daddy on your 40-year-old mistakes. Stop talking about my daddy didn't throw me the ball and now you got grandkids on your own. At some point in time, you got to look at your dysfunctional family tree and shake it off and keep going. I dare somebody in here to say that in spite of my crazy family, I got to keep on going. And can I help you real quick that if you really study psychology and you ever look at the definition and the dynamics of a dysfunctional family, you'll probably realize and recognize that all of us have a dysfunctional family. Ain't nobody in here come out of a perfect family. You thought Obama was perfect until you saw behind the scenes. His daughter lost her mind temporarily too. We all got a little crazy in us, but you gotta learn how to keep on moving. Stop blaming your family tree on why you're stuck in a position. And then number 2, the difficult places may appear in your life, but you gotta keep on going. God never promised you it would be easy. He just promised you I'd never leave you nor forsake you. God never promised you that I'd do everything for you, but he said I'd give you the means and the ability to do it. I like when Dr. King said that the belief that God will do everything for you, that's not faith, that's superstition. And there's too many people in the church full of superstition. I don't care how long we would have prayed at this altar, this stage wouldn't have been built. It took hammers and nails and sweat and time and patience and more nails and more lumber and more patience and more time. And that's how your life is. Somebody asked me a decade, why you didn't wait till you had everything built out before you moved in? Because that's an unrealistic picture of life. If you wait till you get it all right, you'll be waiting for the rest of your life. Sometimes you gotta just jump in the deep water and learn how to swim when the sharks show up. Sometimes you gotta make your mind up. The best place to start is right now. The best place to start is where you're at right now. I dare you to tell your neighbor the best time to start is now. The best place to start is where you are right now. Number 3, You've been disappointed. You've been faced with disappointment. People close to you disappointed you. People around you disappointed you. Life disappointed you. But you gotta keep going. I dare you to keep going. I dare you to tell your disappointment. You won't hold me down. Another millisecond of my life, I'ma get up and keep going. Is there anybody here and you've ever been disappointed? You thought that was the one. You thought that was the job. You thought that was the man. You thought that was the woman. You thought that was the pastor. You thought that was the church. You thought that was the neighborhood. You thought that was position. But as soon as you got it, you realized that was false advertisement. And it wasn't what it was meant to be. You thought you had a Boaz, but you really had a bozo. And life sent you a bag of disappointment. But you gotta get up and keep going. You gotta get up and keep going. Tell your neighbor you gotta get up and keep going. Number four may be hard. Number four may hit you. But when death comes, you gotta keep on going. When death comes, you gotta keep on going. Let me tell you right now, the first seed that was sown into this vision, I gotta share this story. When I was praying about going public with what we were gonna do here, before I told anybody, I just started talking to God. I was mimicking Nehemiah. I didn't even tell my wife. I didn't tell my brothers. I didn't tell my members. I just said, God, you put something on my heart. But before I say a word, I gotta make sure I'm hearing from you and I'm not hearing from emotions. So I kept talking to God, and then I got a phone call. No, actually, somebody met me at the back of the church, at the school. There was a mother said, my son, he got some money for you, and he want me to give it to you real bad. Well, I thought it would have been a couple of dollars, you know. But when I got to the house, and the young man gave me the seed, he said, I want you to do whatever you want to do with it. You can buy with it. I said, but do you mind if I hold on to it? Because God got something in my spirit, but I can't share what it is yet. He said, you can do whatever you want to do with it. And up to this date, it's been the biggest seed sown into this ministry. But just the other day, he gave me a seed to move the church to Greens Point. But Greens Point took his life. He died around the corner just the other day. But his mama here in church right now. His sister here in church right now. His daddy here in church right now. His nephews here in church right now. His niece here in church right now. Because they made their mind up. Yes, death may hurt, but we gotta keep on going. We gotta keep on going. We gotta keep on going. We may live, we may live, we may cry, we may weep, but we gotta keep on going. I dare somebody to holler, I gotta keep on going. Because along this journey, there will be distractions, but you gotta keep going in spite of distractions. What the devil does, he tries to distract you to get you off your journey. That's why people would aggravate you and try to distract you to get you off your journey. But you gotta be wise enough to shake off distractions. You gotta be wise enough to tell distractions, not this season. I'm on a journey, and this journey I'm on, it's too important for me to come off the wall. I gotta stay on the wall. I gotta complete my journey. I gotta complete my task. I'm not coming down this season. I won't start and stop this season. I won't whine and complain this season. I won't become stagnant this season. I won't drop the ball this season. But I'm gonna run. I'm gonna run. And I'm gonna run. I'm on my journey. And listen. Listen.
Thank you, Lord.
On this journey.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
I would love.
Hallelujah.
For your life journey to collide.
Yes, Lord. Thank you.
With this journey of this house.
Thank you.
I would love on this first. On this first Sunday at 200 Greens Road, if you need a pastor, you need a coach, you need need someone that's going to pray with you and pray for you and push you to your destiny. I don't want you coming just to sit on the seat. I want you coming because you want somebody in your life to push you into your destiny, to help you along your journey. As they get ready to sing this song, if you want this church, this ministry on this amazing journey. You know what I forgot to tell you? I forgot to tell you this, that the journey is so aggressive that everything you see here over the next 60 months, we're going to buy it all. You hear me? We're going to buy it all. And we're going to fill up seats. We're going to buy more seats to fill up more souls.
Yeah.
And I would love for you to be a part of this journey. So if you're here this morning, they're ready to sing. You desire for this ministry to become your place. But you're ready to get busy, to go to work, to save a community, to win a community, and to restore families. Come to this altar now. Come. I know you're here. You've been distracted. You've been disappointed. You've experienced death. You've experienced all kind of difficult setbacks. But today is a day of new beginnings. Today is a day you can get back on the journey. Today you can be surrounded by people of faith that will encourage you and push you to your destiny. Come. Come, come, come. Come. If you hear, come.
He's able.
He's able.
He's able.